Are you struggling to come up with original content week in and week out? Start a podcast. Interview your ideal clients, let them talk about what they care about most, and never run out of content ideas again. Learn more at sweetfishmedia.com.
You're listening to the B2B Growth Show, a podcast dedicated to helping B2B executives achieve explosive growth. Whether you're looking for techniques and strategies or tools and resources, you've come to the right place. I'm James Carberry.
And I'm Jonathan Green.
Let's get into the show. Welcome back to the B2B Growth Show. We are here today with Nic Poulos. He is a partner at Bowery Capital. Nic, how are you doing today?
I'm great. Thanks for having me.
Thank you for joining us today, Nic. So we're going to be talking today about why less is more in B2B. But before we get into that, I'd love for our listeners to just understand a little bit of context about you, Nic. Tell us a little bit about Bowery Capital and what you guys are doing up there.
Yeah, absolutely. Bowery Capital is a seed stage venture capital firm. We are based here in New York, but investing all over North America. We focus exclusively on enterprise software. So that's all software plays, mainly SaaS, selling into the enterprise. So all B2B plays. And that's really run the gamut from marketing sales software to analytics, security, ERP, vertical software, you name it. We've probably thought deeply or invested in the space. We're working with founders to really not only give them that initial foundational capital, but also to help accelerate their growth and position them well for future rounds in that first 2 years post go-to-market. And that's hopefully a good overview for the audience here.
So Nic, as we were talking before we started recording about why less is more in B2B, you had three very specific things that were top of mind for you as you were thinking about this idea. The first one of those was related to testing channels. And there are a couple different things that kind of spun off of that. Talk to us about, and as you're thinking, with all the technology companies that you're working with at Bowery, this idea of testing channels was number one for a reason. Talk to us, expand on it a bit for us.
Yeah, absolutely. I'd say this point covers really just allocation of resources really early on in general, as you're thinking about it from a marketing sales perspective. And the reason it came to mind for me is, when you first go to market or you first kind of raise your seed round, I think there's an inclination to say, we have all of these potential channels out there, right? You got all the paid channels, you got social media and content marketing, you got an event strategy, and you could go on and on, especially if you include various sales strategies. But really, you've got to recognize you have limited burn, you have limited resources. Almost more importantly, you have limited, man hours, and that includes mind share of the CEO. And you can only really do a limited number of these channels as well as you can at the same time. Mm-hmm. So in other words, what you should really do is choose the channels that you think are going to be most valuable for you and ensure that you test them properly. So make sure that you have the processes and systems in place to collect information about, if it's a marketing initiative, make sure that you have understanding of how you're going to test return on, marketing investment. If it's a sales strategy or channel, make sure that you're properly recording CRM information, you're properly tracking pipeline, and you're asking the right questions throughout the sales process in order to understand, is this converting better? If it's not, you can try new ones, but less is more when it comes to testing channels early.
Where's the mistake, Nic, that you see a lot of companies making? They're just trying to go all in on all these channels before they test to see what's really yielding the best results?
To be honest, if I had to distill down to the biggest mistake, it is not properly collecting the data that you need in order to then retrospectively measure, was this a success or not? Mm-hmm. And I think this applies both to marketing and to sales. Just to take one example, draw it out a little bit, If you have a theory that your product sells best into the CFO, and you have an SDR or an AE for that matter who is talking to leads all day, he or she should be recording, am I getting into the CFO initially? Like, what initial role am I talking to? And then, you look at your conversion to opportunities based on that role. So, and of course, all that requires setting up a CRM properly, thinking about the appropriate fields, and setting policy in your sales and marketing organization such that all that information is reliably recorded. Otherwise, you really can't look back and say, it's all fine and dandy if you're crushing bookings every quarter. Mm-hmm. But if you miss bookings that first time around, or you're failing to generate sufficient leads as a marketer, you need to be able to look back and say why. And so that's why initial process in order to collect data that you need, especially as it relates to, CRM, basic marketing automation platforms, it really pays to set up that infrastructure early.
Awesome, Nick. So this next thing that we're going to talk about is this idea of letting the prospect do the bulk of the talking. This is something I've heard a lot of people say before, but I think it's worth talking about again because of how important it is. Elaborate on this idea of letting the prospect do the talking.
Yeah, I think you could apply this both to selling a prospect or nurturing a prospect. But at the end of the day, what you're trying to do is understand what the guy or gal on the other end of the phone wants. Mm-hmm. And you're trying to understand what their problem is and how you could potentially help them. And if you can't, and if their problem is different, it's a waste of everyone's time and resources if you continue the conversation too far, or if you continue pestering them, or you overpromised. There's an element of ask questions, not only to show that you're trying to solve a problem for them, but also you're collecting valuable information about your lead in this case that can help you determine, do they fall under my ideal customer profile? Can we actually help them here? And throughout the process, you're also hopefully building a level of trust. Don't promise something you can't do. Instead you can say something along the lines of, this is along the roadmap, but you would have the opportunity to become an early customer and we can build this with you, right? So to some extent, less is more in terms of don't be too salesy, right? I'm not going to tell sellers how to do their work or marketers how to do their work, but as many questions as you can often be a good thing.
Yeah, absolutely. And I think the more they're talking, the more opportunities that you have to identify a problem that your product or your service can actually solve. And so it just practically to me, it makes sense. The struggle is how do you, I think we're so hardwired and trained to want to, talk about our product, talk about our solution, talk about how we can help. Mm-hmm. And so we're just not thinking thoughtfully about, okay, what questions can I actually ask to get them to do the talking? And so that's been something that I've just been wrestling with a lot recently, is thinking thoughtfully about what kind of questions can I ask that will allow them to do the bulk of the talking and give me the insight that I need to actually be able to determine if what we can do for them is going to be helpful. So that's something I've been studying on recently.
Yeah, no, I mean, that's a great point. Let me just add one final thing there. If you think about it, and I mean, in this day and age, all of us are probably constantly being sold something over email. Think about when a seller comes to you and hits you with a paragraph of information about their product. If it's not a perfect fit, if you don't happen to be thinking about that right now, it's just annoying. Yeah. But if somebody comes to me and I say, hey, it's not a fit, and I've gotten this many times from some great salespeople, and they follow up and they say, just out of curiosity, what were you using? Or somebody opens and says, what's your biggest problem? Mm-hmm. That answer, that's easy. I know I can respond to that quickly and I'm fine doing it. And I still may not buy the products, but at the very least you're getting information about. So let's say I say, hey, stop emailing me. I'm not going to buy this. The more that information you glean from me before then, the more you can figure out, okay, Nic wasn't a fit. Mm-hmm. Why is that? And how should we change who we go out to? So,
yep. Yep. No, I love it. This last piece we're going to talk about, Nick, is having a simple but highly resonant value prop. You know, this one, again, makes perfect sense, but elaborate on it a little bit so our listeners can understand the depth of what you're talking about here.
Sure. Yeah. I mean, I think this one probably comes off as the most obvious, but, you know, often I find it, especially early on, it can be difficult to realize how simple you actually want to eventually be. I mean, you want, you know, if you look at the website of successful growth stage companies, they rarely have a tagline or subtitle, if you will, that's more than say 5 or 6 words long.
Yeah.
And, you know, that's because like anything else, you only have about, you know, 5 seconds to grab someone's attention. So early on, you know, you're spending a lot of time on engineering, on product development. You know, the entire team is full of data points around how performant your product is, how it's better than competitors, its various features that it can and can't do, which hopefully for any prospect, they'll eventually understand that. But your goal is, in terms of positioning the product, is to come up with a very impactful, like, hey, what are the couple of words not only that speak to what we can do, but that engage our prospects quickly, that help people understand how big the opportunity is. And, you know, I'll add just this final thing there. This same thing, for better or worse, is relevant to entrepreneurs or startup leaders thinking about future investment as well. Because, you know, the often the simpler your elevator pitch is, not only easier it makes it for downstream investors to understand what you're doing is, but the more complex that statement is, likely the smaller your TAM seems. Does that make sense?
Yeah. And when you say TAM, just for the folks listening that don't understand that, that's your addressable market?
Yeah, that's total addressable market, right? Which is, look, it's always a kind of subjective thing. Like, what's your, you know, current addressable market versus eventual? And I get it, it's nuanced. But to take the words from folks who have come before me, it's you know, you're looking to peel back the onion, right? Mm-hmm. And this is both for a sales process and a potential fundraising. Start with the big idea. Like, here's what we can do. Here's what we will be doing in 10 years. And then peel back to, okay, you know, here's what's on the roadmap. Here's what we're doing now. Here's what's aspirational.
Love it.
But, you know, you gotta hook them in first with that short and sweet value prop.
Nick, this has been fantastic. If there's somebody listening, they want to stay connected with you, they want to learn more about Bowery Capital, what's the best way for them to go about doing that?
Yeah. You know, you can always come visit BoweryCap.com or our Crunchbase profile to get a better sense for the firm. If you're, you know, interested in connecting with me personally, or I'd say probably most members of our team, you know, just to be upfront, the easiest way is always a warm intro, just given volumes of email. But I do also try to stay as active as I can on LinkedIn and Twitter. So that's definitely a good route as well.
Nick, again, this has been fantastic. I really appreciate your time today. So thanks a lot.
Yeah, absolutely. I really appreciate you having me.
If you're a B2B marketer, we want to feature you on sites like the Huffington Post, Social Media Examiner, and Chief Marketer. Every week, we send out a question related to B2B marketing. We use the responses to those questions to fuel the content we write for really popular websites. So head over to sweetfishmedia.com/questions and sign up today.
Thank you so much for listening. Until next time.